We've been farming there for 25 years, and about 4 years ago, we started growing hops. People said, yeah, it'd be a good crop, and it used to grow around here, and we figured, well, we'll give it a try. What you see is a good example of locally grown hops. That's my hand there, so we are very much involved. In growing hops, a lot of things need to be taken into account. You need decent soil, and it needs to be fairly deep soil, because when you put the posts in the ground, they need to go down about 4 feet to support them. The posts are about 18 feet high. So if you've got, you know, a foot of soil and then bedrock, it's going to be hard to put down the post to be able to support it. So start off with
18 feet.
18 feet tall. Our trellises are 18 feet high. So we started off with about 3/4 acre section. We got things laid out. We started putting in the corner posts. Those corner posts are 6x6, pressure treated. They're 24 feet long. They're down 4 feet in the ground, and so they stick up about 2 feet above where the trellis is. After you get the corner post in, you put in all the center posts, and you start putting your plants out. The plants, when they come, are rhizomes. You know, they look like a tulip rhizome or whatever. They're about 4 or 5 inches long, about the thickness of your pinky. If you look, the plants on the right, you see how much bigger they are. We tried with one variety to get some jumbo rhizomes, and I'll show you a little bit about that later, but the bigger you start with the rhizomes, the faster they're going to grow, and the sooner you're going to get some production out of them. These are my two boys. The guy on the left, my younger son, is now the Deputy Commissioner of Agriculture for the state of Massachusetts, so, but neither of them are afraid to get dirty and do some work. You see the posts, these are the end posts. See the steel cable that's coming down and goes down into the ground, and there's a duckbill on the end of the cable. It's pushed down about 4 feet. It's rated for about 3,000 pounds of tension, so we figured, well, that ought to hold the plants. The second year, when we actually started to get some growth, as soon as they started to grow and get some weight on it, those 6x6s started to bend over about a 20-degree angle. So we had to completely redo the anchor system, and we ended up putting buttresses from a bunker silo. They're 10 inches wide, solid concrete. It's shaped in a triangle. They weigh about 6,000 or 7,000 pounds. So that's what we ended up using for the supports for those posts. After things start to grow is when you find out the problems you have. And hops used to grow quite a bit in this area, but this area is very moist. The varieties that are produced now are developed for the West Coast, the Desert West up in the Yakima Valley and Willamette Valley. So it is a bit different. You can see here one of the hops on the top just started to die. You see that frass in the middle of the picture. We found out they're also susceptible to European corn borers. If you have corn in the area, you could very well have corn borers. And so another thing you got to think about, the borers will actually just dig a hole right through the middle of the plant, and the vines are so small compared to a regular corn plant that once that happens, the top just dies. We also had one variety that just didn't seem to thrive. It just wasn't growing. It would get 6-7 inches tall, we just wouldn't get any taller. You see, it'll spread out, but we just couldn't get really any decent type of plant out of it. So I called an agronomist. He came over. He said, no, the soil's fine. There's nothing there. I called an entomologist. The entomologist said, no, there's no bugs or anything here. And I called a plant pathologist. Pathologist said, no, it's not a fungus and it's not a bacteria. So I ended up sending samples out to Washington State University. And I said, from what I've been able to read and so on, and there's not a lot of literature out on the East Coast about hops. They just haven't been here for 100 years. I said, my best guess is hop stunt viroid. So I sent the samples out. They analyzed it and they said, no, it's not hop stunt viroid, it's apple mosaic virus. And when you get the apple mosaic virus in the plant for several years, there may not be any symptoms. You won't see it. But then at some point, it kicks in and it just stunts the plant. The plant doesn't grow. And that's what happened. We bought the rhizomes. The rhizomes had been infected with the viroid. And once they, quote, started to grow, they just didn't grow very much. That's what a normal plant should look like at that stage. You see, that's the plant on the left, and the stunted one on the right, as you can see, there's just nothing growing there. So that variety, we ended up having to, after the first year, just sprayed it with Roundup, killed it all, and took it out. Once it's infected, you don't get rid of it. Hops are also a favorite food of Japanese beetles. As you can see, it doesn't take long. A few days, and you know, the leaves can start looking like that, and a lot of leaves on the plant can start looking like that. And again, it just skeletonizes them and really makes a mess of the plant. After the first year, you go through, we had 600 plants, and that was a harvest, about 2 pounds of hops. Hops weigh about as much as feathers, So it might look like a lot, but you know, you stop bouncing feathers around, it really doesn't amount to much. The first year around here, the growing season just isn't long enough. So out west, in the desert northwest, where they can start sooner, they've got a better climate for it. They can get close to half production in the first year. Around here, if we get any production, we're lucky. Second year, you can see the shoots starting to come up. They look kind of like asparagus. This was April 11th, I think, 2009. So that's about when they'll start to break ground. Again, just barely coming up from the surface. One thing about the Northeast, we do have a lot of damp weather. You can see this is, I'd say it's probably in June. We can have fogs. Our farm is right down in the Connecticut River Valley. The west border of our farm is the Connecticut River. And so moisture coming off the river, many times, you know, we can have fog like this until 10, 11 o'clock in the morning. 2009 in general was a very wet year. I think in June we had 23 days when there was at least some rain. And so hops are very susceptible to all kinds of fungus. So that was one of the things we wondered, you know, can we grow them around here? Again, you can see it's only about 150 feet from where I'm standing to the end of the row. You can see how foggy it is. There's just so much atmospheric moisture. When that happens, you start getting disease problems. Again, you can see the end of the plant starting to die. The leaves are kind of chlorotic. If they have too much moisture, too much water, the leaves will start to go yellow. Another problem we have, you see that one dead vine right in the middle there. There's another disease, it's called a necrotic root rot. It's a fusarium fungus, and it happens right down at the crown, right down at the level of the ground, and the vine will just start to club over, and you get any wind or anything, any movement, and it just breaks off from the ground. And so the whole plant, the whole vine at that point will just die. Again, it was something we hadn't heard about it, didn't know about it, and just took some research to find out what the problem was. You know, you can have one very nice, strong, healthy vine. Right next to it, you get another one that dies. In the same, actually the same rhizome, the same plant. So it can be a little confusing as to what happens. And again, you can see more. It just turns black and dies. Another problem with the moisture we have is downy mildew. That basically is what drove the hop industry out of the Northeast and out from New York and went farther out west. They like moist weather. It's a fungus. All fungi like moist weather. And so if you're not careful, you don't spray frequently and continuously, you get disease problems, especially with the climate we have. Again, you see more of the same problem. People have asked before, you know, what else can you do with hops? Are there any other uses? And I said, well, you can try growing Christmas decorations at some point, because you can see how that's supposed to be a nice bright green color. The red color, the cones are completely gone. And you can see all the moisture still. If you remember in the second slide, I showed you the jumbo rhizomes, how much faster they were growing. Well, if you look right there, the plants on the left, the hops are all nice and green. On the right, they're all red. What ended up happening when we got the rhizomes, we got them, there were two different shipments. We got one shipment that was infected with downy mildew right in the rhizomes. When that happens, you get it year after year and you just don't get rid of it. We tried seeing what we could do with it. This year, when they start coming up this spring, those plants are gonna be sprayed. But you look at that entire section, 20 plants, we should be getting, 20 to 30 pounds of hops per year. We get nothing out, because by the time they just start to ripen, the downy mildew takes over. It is in the plant, so it's not something you can spray for it and keep it out. Okay, now we got some decent hops. What do you do with them? This is actually the most labor-intensive part and the hardest part. Without a machine, you gotta go through and pick all those by hand. And in, back in the old days, that's what the seniors did, a lot of the seniors and a lot of the young people. They would go out in the fields, they'd cut them down, and they'd just start picking by hand. One person who knows what he or she is doing, picking hops, can pick about 1 pound of hops that will dry, it'll dry to a pound in about 1 hour. So if you figure, well, you know, if hops are selling for $6 or $7 a pound, which sounds like a lot, you gotta pay somebody $10 to get that pound out. That's just to pick them. So you can't do it feasibly picking by hand anymore. Way back when, in this time, yeah, they could because labor was cheap, but you can't do it anymore. That was our effort at it. Excuse the picture, it is kind of grainy, but I didn't have time to do very much because we spent so much time trying to pick hops. In that year, we probably ended up with about 120 pounds of dried hops, and that was four or five people picking for 2 weeks, on a kind of time available basis, but for most of the time. So it's just not a feasible thing to do. Okay, the next year, around the 1st of May, we spray the plants to kill them back, because when the plants start to grow, any disease organisms that are in the plant tends to go to the growing points. So if you wait until there's about a foot of growth out of it, a foot or so, and you kill the plant then, you're getting rid of a lot of the disease organisms. So that tends to help with diseases farther down the line and minimizing them. First week of May, we sprayed them, they were dead right down to the ground. This is June 6th. You can see they're up 12, 14 feet now. That's how fast they grow once they start growing. This, again, it's beginning of June, beginning of July. The trellis up top is 18 feet up. So by the beginning of July, from the beginning of May, those plants have grown 18 feet. Again, another one, and you can just barely see, well, you can't see too well, but the hops themselves, the cones, are just barely starting to form at that point. Hops will grow vertically up until the summer solstice, right around the end of June. At that point, they tend to stop growing up, and they'll start growing out and actually fruiting. Over here, you can see a little bit more. The lighter spots are the cones that are starting to form. You can see the little white spots. That's what they look like when they're just starting. Again, this is the beginning of June. Come the beginning of August, this is what it's going to look like. This, I believe, was around August 8th or 10th. So when they start growing, they grow fast. You can see more. Now, that was this year. To try and pick something like that to any extent, you can't do it by hand. These hops, I mean, these were great. You can see they hop right down almost to the ground. Usually hops, the plants will not put out cones below about 4 or 5 feet. They tend to be more on the upper part of the plant. Sometimes some varieties will do better all the way down. And these were just, as you can see, it's right down to the ground. That was the first picture. You can see the density of the hops, and they really look nice. This year, Mass Department of Ag Resources and the Vermont Agency of Agriculture combined forces, and they started to produce a hop picker. It was based on previous designs, but they wanted to make it portable so it could actually go from farm to farm. Typically, the hop pickers are, you know, they're big machines. They're 14, 15 feet high, and there's a lot to it. So you really can't move it down the road to go from farm to farm. If somebody's growing 100 hop plants, you can't afford, you know, $50,000, $75,000 for a hop picker. So they were getting together trying to help the small farmers. And this machine first came to our place. When it came to our place, you can see in the back there's a pair of vice grips. If you can see the whole thing, there's cardboard attached and there's more vice grips and clamps. It actually arrived later than it was supposed to. The contractor that was building it just got behind, and we ended up losing about half the crop because there were so many hops we couldn't pick them by hand, and the machine just didn't get there in time to be able to pick them. When you're ready to start picking, our method, we've got a small trailer on the back of a small tractor. We go out in the field, we go out between the rows, cut the plants off at the base, and then we use a staging and cut them off at the top and just drop them on that trailer. And we try and lay them out so it's easy to separate. Once they're down in, you can see the chain up top. There's some, I forget what the term is, but there's a certain kind of hook. And you can just hook the bind around it, and it'll hold. And that chain will go around, and then it'll start to go through the machine. You can see there the business end. Those fingers up top are rotating outward very quickly, outward meaning back towards the front. The chain goes down the middle, right on the side, and so it'll pull the bind right through with all the fingers just ripping everything off. It takes off the leaves, the binds, the laterals, basically everything. These plants were so heavy, I think I fertilized just too much. You can see the amount of green matter. And again, you can see the vice grips and trying to get the thing running right. We spent about a week and a half just getting the thing to work. And then at that point, we started to pick, but like I said, it was very late. This will do about 60 to 70 binds per hour. So once it's working and once it's working well, there should be reasonable production out of it. And again, you can see it just kind of pulls it down through in the back. My younger son was on the back end. He would unhook the binds from the cable and just drop the spent bind on the side. All the hops, all the leaves would fall off. You can see the black belt near the bottom. You see the hops starting to fall off. That's called the dribble belt. Everything dribbles down onto that. Hops are round, so they roll. Leaves are flat, they don't roll. The dribble belts will move things back to the next belt, and so all the hops will just kind of roll off to the bottom, and it does do a good job of taking the leaves out and cleaning it. Here you can see the hops coming down onto the cross conveyor, and then the cross conveyor goes down into the bucket. Back in the old days, this is I was able to take a tour in Europe a few years ago. This is how they used to spray. I don't know what their health would be, but people typically didn't live very long back then anyway. This is a modern hop yard in the Czech Republic. You can see those actually a little taller than ours. They go 6 meters, which I think is just under 20 feet tall. But you can see the density that they plant, and everything is nice and clean, and they do a good job over there. This is what they used to actually cut the vines down and bring it in. The bottom right is the business end. That will go along, it'll cut the vine at the bottom, and it'll grab it right above that. As the tractor moves forward, that belt will move backwards, but slower than a tractor. So it'll actually pull it out, so the vine just kind of pulls out sideways, and then once it gets to the end, the tension will just rip the vine right off the top, and it'll fall in the trailer in the back of it. Now, for the Occupy Wall Street type, so this is a little older unit, and looks like mostly homemade. This is one of the big wolf harvesters, and that'll take about 400 or 500 vines per hour. You can see just to the right over there, there's the beginning of the feed belt. There's somebody standing there who just picks a vine up off the ground, the butt end of it, the heavy end, hooks it up over there, and it'll just pick it up upside down, and you can see all the vines being fed back into the machine. Like I said, this will do 400 to 500 vines per hour. It goes through. It's very similar to the one that's being built. The fingers are ripping it off horizontally. The vine is being pulled backwards horizontally, and then it goes through several different types of cleaners on this one. When you get the size and the scale of this, there are additional cleaning methods you can use. When it's all done, it's dried, and then it's compacted. Each of these bales will weigh about 200 pounds. At the beginning, I said we'd like to use nice flat land. This is what they have in Europe. If there's much of a pitch on the ground that's going on, I wouldn't want to be the one up on the top of that basket. And for the control freaks in the area, you can see they even got the steering wheel up there, but it really doesn't do much. The way they set the strings in Europe, they actually use wire to go down most of the way, but at the very top, they just use some twine. And the reason they do that, like I said, they actually pull the bind off the top, so the wire is much stronger than the string. So as they grab it, they pull the wire holes, it takes the bind with it, the string up top breaks. And so that works out well for them, and they do a lot of hops out there. I also went out to Yakima Valley this past fall, where in the US where they grow hops. This is a hop picker. It actually grows, it harvests two rows at a time. This goes forward, it cuts the bottom of it, and it actually strips off most of the bind right in the field. And once the bind gets to the end, it just chops the bind up, leaves it down for mulch. Then it's only taking the leaves, the hops, and the lateral, so there's just a lot less material that they have to transport back and forth. You can see here the cutter bars up top to cut the strings off at the top, and those are double helicals going in opposite directions, actually both feeding in. So if the guy driving it isn't quite straight with the rows, because there are two different rows, that would actually keep it fed towards the middle of it. That was a homemade rig. Most of the ones out there, many of them, are homemade. The farms out there, I was at one of the small farms that was over 700 acres. In Europe, they tend to be 10 to 50 acre farms, much smaller, so they tend to use more manufactured type harvesters and the manufactured equipment. Out west, they're big enough, and there's so few of them, it's tough to make a harvester for manufacturing business stay in business if you're only selling one or two machines a year. So out west, they do tend to make a lot of their own equipment. You can see here the trucks are just going in. You saw the wolf harvester and what was feeding it. There's actually four of the equivalent of those in this building. So again, the large farm, they're gonna do a lot of throughput in a hurry. That's what the hops look as they go into the dryer. And that pile of hops behind us, you can see the height. That's one day's picking. It's 54,000 pounds of hops from one farm one day. So again, when they get going, they do a lot of, that's our hop dryer. We have four of those. It's about 6 feet wide, 12 feet long, and about 18 inches high. So we can probably put a couple hundred pounds of hops in there total.
Is it heated?
We don't use heat. We don't use heat directly. We have that mounted up in the barn. So it's fairly warm up there anyway on a sunny day. That does blow air up through it, so you don't get the hot temperatures that you would get with the other dryers. It just tends to preserve the oils a little better and preserves the aroma part. We tend to grow more aroma hops rather than the alpha hops. Alpha's cheap. Aroma isn't. to try and compete with out west for alpha. There's no way we could do it out here. It just costs too much. They're just so much bigger, so much more efficient. So we try and concentrate on the aroma part. Once it's gone through the compactor, again, this isn't ours, this was out west, that brick will weigh just about 200 pounds. They sew the burlap up around it, and then they stack it for storage. They put it in cold storage right around 30, 32 degrees, and they can keep it for, you know, a couple years at that temperature. The building we were in, the building itself would hold 2 million pounds of hops, and it had five different buildings on that site. So a tremendous amount of hops growing out in that area, and you can see they keep things neat, and they get a lot of production out. Everybody has their problems. Out west, they didn't have a problem with moisture. They don't have a problem with moisture, but they get their equivalent of the Santa Ana winds that you hear about from California. All those reddish hops, they're not diseased, they're sandblasted. Just before harvest, they had this windstorm come through. It lasted, I think, a couple days, and it just blew the wind all over the place. It literally sandblasted the hops. And so they looked like hell, but you know, there was no disease over there, and so they were able to sell the hops anyway. Again, that's looking from the top. The picture's not great, but that was, I was standing on top of that harvester that I mentioned at the beginning of the West Coast trip. So you can see the plants themselves, they look kind of wilted, and they're just really sandblasted. There's a different type of setup that people are experimenting with. It's called a low trellis system. I mentioned that our hops, our trellises are 18 feet tall. Most of them out west are 18 feet. In Europe, they're closer to 20 feet. It's very expensive doing that, and as far as stringing it and so on. They're experimenting with a low trellis, which is, they vary from 9 to 12 feet tall. Once you get that, I'll call it that shorter height, you can actually get a machine that will go right over the tops of all the hops. The hops are actually grown on netting. They still put the posts in the ground, but they're much smaller posts. They run a fish net down in between the posts. You don't have to train the hops, they just start growing up the fish net. So you save on training, you save on the stringing each year. The harvester, this harvester, they were actually building it, and they're trying to perfect it. This, I believe they said they had a little over $200,000 into it at that time. That was the back end. This is the side. You can see it's fully self-propelled. It's got its own motor. This is the front. You see the steering wheel. That steering wheel is actually functional up top. So the guy up there just drives right over the top of the row, and the fingers will start from the bottom because that's the strongest part, and they just keep ripping up. And as they rip everything off, there's a couple of conveyors on the side. That feeds all the material that's been torn off to the back, and there's a conveyor up on the back that goes and feeds it into a truck. So the truck, again, it's not taking the entire bind. It's only taking the leaves, the laterals, and the hops themselves. So it's just less material to be transported. This, I thought, was the neatest harvester I'd seen. You can see, obviously, it's a homemade rig. It's all self-propelled. And you see up top there, just to the left of the guy, the looks like a round thing up there. That's actually two car tires. And there's a hydraulic motor. They're actually touching. There's a hydraulic motor that spins it really fast. And right here, you can see that little opening. The guy will take the hop bind, the base of the bind, and he will put it in there. And once the bind gets to those wheels, they're spinning fast. It just rips the whole bind right through there. So the bind itself goes through, everything else is ripped off, and the bind literally will sail back about 30 feet and land down behind it. And I just thought it was neat watching the thing. This is the end product. When I went with one of the owners of Berkshire Brewing Company, Gary Bogoff. He was going out to sample hops and see what he was going to be buying. This is how they bring them out. It's a brick about this big. And take it, rub it, sniff it, see which ones you like. This is Cascade, and it's just a really nice looking product. And once you've gone to this point, this is kind of the semi-end product. The end product actually is what it goes into. We all enjoy beer, but just make sure that when you're done, you look like the guy on the left and not the guy on the right. Actually, what you see there is the beer we had had, but it Steve had a rough night, I guess. This was a trip to Europe, and we just got him at the wrong time. So that's the show. Any questions?
Yes. Have you any experience with pelletizing?
We have not, we just use the whole hops. Foothill Hops out in New York, they pelletize some of their hops, they sell some whole leaf. Again, that's a whole nother process and, you know, more work involved. We may end up going that way, but right now we're just trying to, you know, one stage at a time. Yeah?
What varieties are you growing?
I'm sorry?
What varieties are you growing?
We grow Cascade, Magnum, Willamette, Mount Hood, Kent Golding, and which other one? Nugget. I don't know if I said that. Six varieties. The first year, the ones I show you were stunted, were a Sterling. We tried those. Like I said, that didn't work, so we took those out. We put Mount Hood in. Of the varieties, we grow the Kent Golding. We haven't gotten an ounce off them in 4 years. It's an English variety. I think they just need more, you know, longer day length. The Cascades have been doing well. The Magnum and the Nuggets have been doing fairly well. Willamette, Mount Hood, eh. So this year we're going to be expanding. We're going to be expanding with the first three, Cascade, Magnum, and Nuggets.
How do they compare to the West Coast varieties, would you say? Flavor, aroma? What are you noticing difference as far as, you know, the terroir?
More aroma. Some of the brewers who have been using them, we just sell them to them as wet hops. So you just have that much more material, that much more aroma there. Even after we dry them, because we don't dry them under 140 degree temperatures, there's just more aroma left there. And one of the, I won't call it a complaint, but one of the comments I have, when they brew the beers with our hops, to me it's almost too hoppy. There's just, you know, that much more flavor. They could probably cut back a little bit, and but they're the brewers, they know a lot better than I do.
How do you deal with the Japanese beetles?
We use a product called Conserve. It's certified organic. It's actually, I think it's the active ingredient of BT,
okay.
Bacillus thuringiensis. And I think there's actually two different compounds that they use, but that does do a reasonable job on them.
Okay.
Anything else?
And you're going to stick around, right?
Yeah, I'll be here, at least until the beer sampling.
How do we get your product?
We sold out in 2 weeks. This coming year, we hope to have more. We've got a website, 4starfarms.com. Give us a call, and my daughter-in-law, Liz, will answer. We are a family farm. There's myself, my wife, my two sons, my two daughters-in-law, and my grandson. We have one other employee. He's our mechanic, and he actually knew my wife before I did. They were both in 4-H together, so it is a family farm.
Thank you, Gene.
Mm-hmm.
Next up, we've got Dorn Cox from Tuckaway Farm in Lee, and Lee's been growing grains for
five or six years, maybe.
Okay. Yeah.
So, like Carl said, our farm's down in Lee, New Hampshire, about 2 miles from the university, and I actually started growing grains because we've been growing oil seeds for biodiesel processing and culinary oil. But you need a rotation with all the oil seeds. You can't grow them year after year because in a conventional or organic system, you lose 30% yield regardless. So you have to have a rotation, and grains are an excellent rotation. But as we started looking into it, I got more and more excited about growing the grains. Recently became the director of Green Star, which is a New Hampshire-based nonprofit, which has a mission to foster a resilient food and energy system in New Hampshire. So I always, before I start any presentation, I also like to show this map here of New Hampshire soils. All that green are soils of state, local, and prime ag soils. That's about 40% of the total land area in New Hampshire. We're using well less than 10% of that in current production right now, and the current production is only providing 5% of our food and fuel needs. If we were producing, and so you can say our current crop and pasture land is like one of the next to top round circle there, you overlay that's what we're actually in active cropland production right now. If we produced at, say, the level that we use that same land as intensively as a country like Switzerland does, we'd be producing a surplus of food for our population. So you overlay about 40,000 acres of grain onto that, that produces enough calories to feed all 1.3 million people at 1,100 pounds per acre, which isn't a great yield. So just to give you that sort of general background about what's possible here. Now, if we wanted to also have beer, we're going to have more than 30,000 acres. but that just gives you, there's a clicker. I'm just gonna have a few photos of different examples of grain grown on our farm and some of the other farms that we're working with. We started about 4 years ago, a number of farms. We're interested in growing grain. We called ourselves the Great Bay Grain Cooperative. And at that point, as far as we know, there hadn't really been significant quantities of wheat grown in New Hampshire since around the Civil War time. Although at that point, the Mount Washington area was pretty well known as a wheat growing region. So that means we missed all of the infrastructure developments in the rest of the country. That was right around the time when they were just starting to use the sickle bar mower. Reaper binder was just in the early stages. So certainly no self-propelled combines. And so as we start out on this, we're working against having no experience with the equipment, no experience growing the crop, no experience storing it, no experience transporting it, cleaning it, et cetera. So it's, we said we'd give ourselves 5 to 7 years before we made a decision. And when we started, we had, I think between the group, we had one pull-type combine. They're now in our group, which is mostly in Rockingham and Stratford County, I think there are 9 combines, about 4 self-propelled, the rest are smaller pull types. And I realized there are a whole bunch more photos that I didn't know how much time I had, so this is pretty short. So I've just got a few. But this is a Gleaner K2 combine. When we got this from Iowa, we got 2 of them on one single flatbed trailer, had to drop the tires down to fit on the flatbed. But we fit 2 of them on with 4 different heads. So we cut down on trucking cost. So that's about the sort of the smallest. In about 81, they stopped making combines that were anywhere close to the scale that we can get around on our roads in between fields. So this has a 10-foot head. The other one has a 13-foot head. There's another one. So this is actually harvesting rye. This is harvesting a hard red spring wheat. That's the other gleaner. That's in Rollinsford. The other one was in Lee. We also been doing some working with some smaller scale equipment. There's a modern reaper binder, leaving the sheaves there. That's a red fife wheat down in Hampton, New Hampshire. We've been also working to do some variety testing. We have 9 varieties that we're trialing from wheat breeder Steve Jones. He's selecting these particularly to express a wide variation so that they can be selected on farm. They'll express in lots of different ways. And the base genetic material on this has a root in some of the varieties that had been here historically, but with some modern variations. And we've seen huge variation in production amongst those 9 varieties. And we're just growing that out enough. So when we started, we had maybe a few grams of seed. You could probably, you could hold it in the palm of your hand. And I think this year, our third year, we've grown it out to, it'll probably take a little over, we'll probably be up to 1/2 acre or 1 acre of wheat. One thing a lot of people who start out in small scale, thinking that, in small scale, you can do stationary threshers or hand thresher. And it's true, you can, but this is one thing, just like with the hops, mechanization is, it's just unbelievable the difference in productivity. And it's more something if you really enjoy doing that or the romance of it, but from a production standpoint, it's really not feasible. So this was even with a reaper binder, which is the way they did it up until the middle of this century. Those wheat plots that we did, which was probably maybe a quarter acre, less than a quarter acre last year, it took us not counting harvesting, two people, maybe 2 days to get through that, which is takes a lot more time because we're also being very careful to separate out the varieties. But very, if with a self-propelled combine harvester, like you said before, it would have been less than a minute or something along, I mean, really, it's a huge, huge, huge difference. Now, that also included, you know, screening and cleaning and so forth. But just to give you a sense of the difference in efficiency. And I really wish I'd put a slide in here. You know, if you're interested in growing a couple acres, you know, an Alice Chalmers all crop pull type combine or John Deere pull type combine are fairly inexpensive, and they do an excellent job. Some of them have baggers and seed cleaners built right in, which work because they go so much slower, they can actually screen out the seed, and that's a perfectly acceptable way to go, but I wouldn't recommend it. Planting, we're doing a lot of work with no-till drill, but which is very much like a regular grain drill, except that it's a little heavier and has heavy-duty coulters. We're doing organic no-till, so that's a little different, but if you're doing conventional, you can spray down the sod prior to planting. Otherwise, you're going to be cultivating and then using a conventional regular drill, which just doesn't have it's not quite as aggressive. But for most of the grains that you might be growing for beer, you're going to want a drill as opposed to a broadcast type seeder or a brilliant seeder. They just don't do as good a job getting the seed soil contact. They tend to lay on the surface, and you have a lot. You have to use more seed and you get poorer germination. So, highly recommend a drill. And again, you can get a conventional drill for not a lot of money, under $1,000 if you're interested. They're out there. But I would highly recommend that. So, you know, the old idea of like broadcast seeding like this, you're gonna have a much poorer result than if you get that properly drilled into the soil. We're also, because we're a certified organic operation, we're doing a lot with interseeding and trying to do minimum till and preserving the soil as we're going from what was maybe pasture or hay-based system, try to preserve the soil even though we're doing more crop rotations. So here we have oats interseeded with red clover, and actually I see a little vetch in there, unfortunately. Here we just skim tilled, so this was a single pass operation where we planted the oats and the clover in March, last week in March, but we didn't, because we're doing it one pass, we didn't totally kill the sod, but that was all right, because the you can see there's some timothy and orchard grass that came up early, but it by the time it matured, the oats were coming in right behind, and they weren't really competing. So we were able to get a reasonable oat crop harvested. You can't really even see the clover is just coming up a little bit after that. We were able to get the oat straw, and then had a reseeded hay field with a lot higher legume content that fall, which actually produced, it had actually been excellent grazing, but we ended up taking the clover hay off it. So integrating grains can be part of a sod or a pasture rotation. And one of the things that where we're going is actually integrating it with a grazing operation, so we can over graze it instead of, and go to a no-till grain situation. Especially oats are very competitive with the annual grasses. And they're doing this in Australia, right? So some other photos, winter wheat. I think this photo actually shows, you can sort of see a slight different color. On the left is triticale, and on the right is winter wheat. You can see the triticale is a cross between wheat and rye. We've had good luck with that. It's been very hardy, very productive. The only thing is when you're harvesting, it has the awns, the hairs on it, which when you're combining can be a real pain. If you don't have your air set right, they can grab onto each other and And, you know, I grew up haying, and you thought haying was, like, you know, sweaty and sticky, and it's nothing compared to working on a combine in the middle of the, you know, the middle of the summer and having, and you've probably heard about, you know, barley. Barley also has those odds. You've never been so itchy in your life. So, yeah, it took me half a day in the middle of July once the air got, because once they start sticking to each other, they form a mat, and then they form, it gets thicker and thicker, less air going through, and then it just plugged up the whole back, and it's just the, you know, this mat of like, so yeah, this field especially, it was really funny, because when we started that, you know, this is sort of where the counter to what you normally hear about talking to old timers, all we got to this group that were started growing grains is you can't do that here. and so we like to, we were just chuckling when we had this this winter wheat field, and I it was probably over 2 tons an acre that we're getting in grain there. Ton an acre is something that I think we're all pretty happy with, I think. Certainly the record yields are more in the 4 ton plus, I mean, so that's possible. Something to shoot for. Here again, that just a little mid-season around where that tree is, that's all a spring wheat, a hard spring wheat, where we took a little bit of the hay field out just to see how that would work. Get a little close up. And another hard spring red wheat, immature. This was an experiment I just threw in there. This was the minimum till wheat right into that hay sod. Wheat compared to the oats require a lot more nitrogen, and when we're not tilling as much, we're not freeing up as much nitrogen. So, especially for a high quality wheat, you really have to make sure that you're getting enough nitrogen on, either through manure or green manure is working it in with cover crops, so that's one of the big challenges, not only getting it enough, but making sure it has it enough at the right time. And I'd sort of say in order, I don't have nearly as much experience with the barley as I do with the wheat and oats at this point, but the oats are by far the easiest crop to grow if you're going to start out. They will produce at higher volumes and are much more forgiving as far as soil conditions. They're very vigorous. Winter wheat has also been easier as far as weed control. If you're a conventional, spring weeds can be a little easier because you can control spring weeds. And again, it'll be interesting to hear from the beer brewers, because I'm coming at this from sort of an animal feed and flour and, you know, baking perspective. So the desirable characteristics as far as managing these and the varieties for beer brewing is going to be really interesting to figure out. And I'm excited to learn more about what we should be looking for. But you can see this was single pass, just right into the hay field. We actually did get probably maybe 600 pounds an acre, so poor yield, but again, we had very little into it. And that came right back, and we had seeded some clover in with it. So as part of reseeding the hay field, we're getting a grain crop as well. So not a great, if you're just looking for the wheat yield, not that great, but still not terrible. So just some photos of around the corner from us, we were harvesting one of the UNH fields. So I believe that's triticale. So at this point we've done some, we have experience with oats and some barley, not as much as we'd like, and we've had some challenges with that because barley seems to be one of the more challenging than sort of smut. And also the varieties I think need to be refined for this area. The straw is not as strong, so we tend to see sort of more lodging, and if you have too much nitrogen, they tends to actually fall over. I have a winter barley I'm really excited about. It has a really good straw. It's supposed to be, it's a feed barley, not a malting barley. But we're certainly interested in all the same sort of growing techniques are going to be applicable for the barley as well. But I do have the winter barley in the ground right now, and it looks very good. winter wheat, spring wheat, spelt, triticale. I'm sure there are some others too, but they, I don't think we've grown one that hasn't, we haven't tried one that hasn't worked at all. It's just been to varying degrees, so it's. So one of the other things is drying. The infrastructure actually doesn't have to be on a small scale, isn't all that cost prohibitive. One of these, you know, these fertilizer type poly bags will hold about a ton of grain, and $250 air fan that you auger into it, you can sort of see it right there. When you stack those bins up together, you can just put one in each bin and that will take the moisture down. We try to get as much drying in the field as we can. The other option, which is used everywhere else in the world, but which we tried out here, is you just dump all the grain out on a big sheet of plastic outside when it's sunny out. And it actually does quite a good job. You just spread it out, and plastic is really cheap. So if, even if you're doing several tons, or several tons over a longer period of time, that's a very cost-effective method. And if you get some weather, you just pull the edges of the plastic over and wrap it up, and as opposed to, you know, you can certainly get rotary dryers and other methods too, but this is, especially on a small scale, very easy to do. This is, apologize for this picture. This is one of the, our Great Bay Grain Co-op farmers put up this grain dryer, and that's just, that has the bottom, is a sort of a false bottom, and the air pushes up through, and no heat, just circulating air, and that, and so he's not a, he's able to not only use all of the grain that he produces on farm and dry it down, but it also enables him to purchase grain from other farms out west right from the field that aren't dried down at a far lower cost. So if you're looking at it from a feed perspective, it's he paid for that, I think he told me, in less than a year. Oh, I guess that's all for photos. I've got tons more later if you like, but I figured that would give you kind of a quick overview. The big point is that you can grow grains here. It requires some infrastructure, but there are a lot of ways to make the infrastructure more fairly cost effective. So, any questions?
Use it off of feed or food?
So that's the nice thing about grain, growing grains, is that you can use it for lots of different things. So if, for example, it goes too weedy early in the season, you can graze it, you can chop it, and feed it. If that you send it to, you know, the wheat lab and the protein's not great, or you have some other flaw that it's not going to make great bread flour, you can feed it. But the higher value is for flour, or I think if we can get it for the brewery market, that's probably going to be higher value than the feed value. But you also have these other byproducts like the straw, and its rotation value in building organic matter and disrupting pest cycles that make it work as well. But we, one of the things that was recently added was a stone grist mill. That's a very, very, it's really not cost prohibitive to start grinding the flour. Other questions? Yes?
Do you have any plans to delve further into barley growing or teaming up with a malster?
Well, I think we just need more variety trials to find ones that really work well here. You know, obviously there's a lot of barley experience in Maine, and UVM has done some variety trials. We just have to get enough folks who are growing it and are willing to talk to one another to figure out what's going to work best here. Because it really is, when we are doing those wheat variety trials, they're also doing those same in Vermont, in a couple locations, and in Maine, those same varieties, and we had vastly different results depending on the location. So it really is something that I think is about finding the right varieties for the right locations. The presentation I did earlier, I mean, there are huge differences in growing areas within just this small state of New Hampshire. I mean, what's going to work in Coos is going to be very different than what works down here. So we just need more folks who are figuring it out, which varieties work well in their systems. But yeah, I'm open for barley. And it's a beautiful, I mean, that's the other thing I should mention. It's just a beautiful crop to have on your farm, too. There's nothing like, you know, the fields, and especially, the rye and the barley with those ponds, and it's golden, and you've got the sun sort of coming through and watching
like
the sun.
Thing, so.
Yeah, it's really wonderful. It's great. And it's been really fun getting the combines set up. There is also nothing like getting into a good patch, and you can just hear the whoosh, whoosh, and you can see the grain coming out and just flowing out in rivers right behind your shoulder.
Any other questions for Dorn before we move on?
Okay.
Thanks. Okay. Our third speaker is Nicole Carrier from
Throwback
Brewery in North Hampton.
We're in North Hampton, New Hampshire.
So, and she's been brewing with local ingredients for a while. The brewery's been operating for how long now?
Well, we sold our first keg in July of this past year, so we're pretty new. But I'll get into all of that.
Okay.
All right.
Take
thank
it
you.
Away. Thanks.
So before I get started, who here has either brewed a beer or knows how the process of brewing works? All right, good. So we got a whole lot of people here. What I'm going to do real quick, I'm just going to give an introduction to our brewery and then talk just real quickly through the brewing process and a little bit about the malting process, and then give you our perspective on what we've brewed with and what we kind of like, and then we have some beer. So I'll try and keep it quick so we can get drinking. Let's see here. Can you guys see if I stand here? I have to. Well, try and move that over here. Throwback Brewery, we're a really small brewery. We're a 3-barrel brewery. There's just two of us. Annette Lee, she's our brewer. I do more of the marketing and operations side of things. Our vision is really to create a truly local beer, a beer that's made within 200 miles of us. And we're about more than halfway there, and there's some challenges to that, and part of it's, what these guys were talking about a little bit. Again, we're pretty new. We sold our first keg in July of this past year, and so it's been a lot of fun. It's crazy starting a brewery. It's any small business, it's really busy. But it's actually pretty rewarding as well. We came up with the name because we wanted to be kind of a throwback to the good old days where there was all different types of breweries, lots of different breweries in communities. And they were founded to support the local communities and to use what was around them. And that's what we really want to do. We want to be, we're on the seacoast of New Hampshire. We want to serve the seacoast. We want to use what's around us. That's sort of our goal. In addition, the name is kind of, throwback a beer, which is sort of a double meaning, so we liked it. In terms of our vision, we came up with a word called beerwar, and I heard someone mention terroir before, and it's sort of a, perhaps a little snooty-ish wine term that talks about, because of the soil variety, because of the weather and the climate, all of those different factors play a role in the wine and in how the grapes turn out. And so we are really striving to create a New England beer noir where, based upon the local ingredients, the grain, the hops, you can say maybe it's slightly more robust hoppiness because we grow hops in this area. So all these different things about using local ingredients to make a beer is what we're really trying to do, and we think you can hopefully eventually taste that difference. In terms of our beers, we do a tremendous variety of beers. We only label 5 of them. The rest we sell through kegs and at the brewery as well. But they're all designed to use what's around us. We'll be tasting, we got maple wheat, I'll talk about that in a bit. But we have a German-style wheat beer that I brought today, the maple wheat porter. The German-style wheat beer, we work with Brookford Farm, which is now in Rawlingsford, but transferring to Canterbury, I think. They grow wheat for us. So a lot of our beers are designed with wheat in mind because that actually grows really well here. So we have a Maple Kiss Wheat Porter. We use maple syrup from Taylor Farms in Meriden. The first couple times we made it, we used some oats from Dorn. But the thing about oats, it was a little bit of a pain because they Ideally, they'd be flaked for us, if you want to know what is great. Flaked oats works a lot better because we tried to mush them up or crush them in the process. It just wasn't really working that well. But oats actually grow really well around here. So if we're trying to figure out you know, how we actually can use that raw oats product in the brewing process.
We now have a dehuller.
Oh, that would actually be awesome. Yeah, so we should talk after this. But then we also have wheat. This product actually has 40% wheat. It's a little bit weird for a porter because most porters are just straight up barley, but we put a lot of wheat into it. And there's malt from Maine and from hops from Foothill Farms, which you were talking about, Gene, in Madison County, New York. So that's one example of our beers and sort of the profile of the local ingredients. I want to talk a little bit about malt really quickly. Malt is, you know, beer ingredients, it's pretty simple. You have water, right? You have hops, you have malt, and yeast, and all sorts of brewing adjuncts, which I'll talk about a little bit later, and we use a lot of them, actually. And the malt really provides the color and flavor and the sugars that then turn into the alcohol. From a malting perspective, I want to talk a little bit about Valley Malt. It's a malting company located in Hadley, Massachusetts. And basically, before they were founded, if you wanted to get grain from a local farm, like Brookford Farm, which we do get a bunch of wheat from, and then you need to malt it to get the sugar out, we'd have to take that wheat, send it off to Canada or somewhere in the Midwest. So even though you're using a local product, you would then have to, you know, have a big amount of cost and also bad for the environment to ship this grain sort of back and forth. So anyways, happens to be that my cousin right here, she's Andrea, and she founded a company called Valley Malt, and they'll take, they're working with local farmers and New York, they have farmers in New York, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Vermont, and Maine, so pretty much all of New England. And they'll take the wheat, the barley, they do triticale, they've done all sorts of different types of grain, and they'll malt it. And malting is basically a pretty simple process, and I'll run through some slides. But right now they just have a one-ton system. They're quadrupling this in the next, I think by March, they're going to have four times the capacity. And right now they're just sort of renting out a little garage type of area. And Andrew's husband, Chris, sort of engineered everything. But the process goes like this. You basically steep the grain. You wet it. This isn't Valley Malt. These are some pictures from other maltsters. Anyways, so the malting process, just real quick, you get the grain, you steep it, right? So it germinates. You halt it by basically kilning it, right? And then you clean it. And so then the result, this is some wheat from Brookford Farm that Valley Malt malted for us and then we'll use in the brewing process. We actually got soft white wheat from them and we have red wheat. The red actually makes a really nice chocolate malt, again, if anyone is interesting from a brewer's perspective. Both are great products. And so once the grain is malted, then the brewing process takes over. And this is our brewery. That's Annette. This is my dog, Hank, who likes to oversee things. And it's a pretty small brewery. We have a 3-barrel mash tun here. This is our hot liquor tank, and that's the kettle. And Annette's sort of finishing up a brew day right here. I think more interesting than the process is sort of some of the ingredients that we'd be interested in. But just one other point is that sort of a mutually beneficial relationship. So we'll get grain from the farmers, and then we'll give it all back to the farms. So we have about 6 or 7 farms that swing by and pick up the grain. It's not harmful to the animals. It's great. In fact, one of our farmers uses it for the pigs that are pregnant. He thinks it's really great for them. So we like to talk about, well, today you'll drink some of our beer and you're really helping out the pigs because the grain will go back to them. So we like to talk about drink a beer and feed a pig. We did have one incident, though, with one of our farmer friends. She has a farm. It's called Black Birch. And she she left the grain outside, and so there's no alcohol in it, but there's still a little bit of sugars. And her son came in, and he said, Mom, Harry's dead. Harry's the turkey, right? So Harry had gotten into the malt and was just apparently dead on the ground, so they put Harry in a box. And then the next morning they woke up and they realized that Harry was in the box. Harry was very much alive. And apparently they left it out in the sun and started fermenting again. It was just in the natural process and it started making some alcohol. So Harry got hammered basically from the grain. So if you do work with a local brewery and you take their grain, I think, you know, if you just keep it in a place where it's not going to start fermenting, or if you like to have a drunken pig or something like that, then leave it outside. We are going to make a beer called Harry's Demise at some point, but hops, yes, we can grow them here, and Gene talked about this, but this is one of the areas where it's a, you know, we're still working on. We get most of our hops from Foothill Farms in New York and in Aroostook County, Maine as well. Okay, this is some of the fun stuff here. We're all really about brewing what's around us, we love to experiment, and we're pretty small, so we will like to make all sorts of different things. That's a bunch of fennel flowers. Now, years ago, Annette and I had made a liquor stout, and we thought, you know, it'd be really fun to use fennel in a stout, because fennel has those nice sort of anise, licorice-y type flavors. And we were working with one of our friends, Josh, who owns Meadows Mirth Farm in Stratum, and we were saying, hey, do you have any fennel? And he said, well, I actually have a bunch of fennel flowers. And we had not even thought about that. But we made this beer with fennel flowers, a stout with fennel flowers, and it was pure magic. So I think it's like one of those things where if you find a brewer that you can work with and you collaborate, you can come up with these beers that are just fantastic. So we coriander, obviously, when you make a wit, there's things you use. So we have got coriander. Jalapenos is another one. We do mostly ales, but we also lager. And we have a Pilsner, which is a Bohemian-style Pilsner, so it's a little hoppier than your traditional Budweiser, you know, lager. And we, one day, were doing lots of experiments with different types of peppers. And we roast jalapenos and we put it in the Pilsner. And I swear to you, like, every single day that we're open at the brewery, someone will come in and say, do you have any of that jalapeno Pilsner? And we'll have to explain now, well, you can't really... jalapenos don't really grow well, you know, in New Hampshire at this period in time, but come back in the summer and we should have some more. But that's another example of and people have just thought that was the best, and they still do, so we'll continue to do that, right? So it doesn't necessarily have to be, if you want to work with a brewer, you don't necessarily have to do hops, you don't necessarily have to do grain or wheat, although we would love it. You can also have local adjuncts. Ginger is another example where... actually, Dorn's sister and Joel, which is, I guess, your brother-in-law, right?
Yep.
They came up to me at the farmer's market a couple weeks ago, and they said, hey, you know, we have some ginger. It just went out of control. Do you want some? And we're like, yeah. So they basically, I went to the farmer's market, and they had boxes of ginger for us. So we are playing around with a chocolate ginger stout and then also a ginger pilsner, which hopefully will come out in the summer. So anyways, and then your typical fruits that most brewers brew with. We use maple syrup, too, and applewood for smoking. All right, some of the challenges with brewing local. Cost, obviously, it costs more for us to buy the product and get it malted locally. But from our perspective, it's sort of the same thing as people that go and understand us and understand our brand and understand what we're driving for know that we're not charging more for the beer because we want to line our pockets with money. It's because we're making a truly local beer. And if you go to a farmer's market, you'll notice that people will pay more for eggs because they know where those eggs came from. They know the chickens are running around free, and you'll know that there's nothing bad in the eggs. In fact, the eggs are probably, you know, if you ask a farmer, they'll tell you the 10 reasons why it's better to eat a local organic egg, right? So the same thing with us is one of the things that people like our beer because they know where it comes from. People are concerned about eating locally, and they should be concerned about drinking locally too and what goes into their beer. In fact, I had some guy came to the brewery yesterday to fill up, and I actually never met him before, but he said he was having, well, I probably shouldn't talk about this, but anyways, I started the story, but he, you know, he had beer from, let's just say, a large manufacturer of beer, and he went to the doctor, he was having all sorts of allergies and rashes and stuff, and the doctor said, what do you drink? And he said, I drink, And so then the doctor said, don't drink anymore, drink, you know, local craft stuff. And so he stopped that, and he started drinking more locally, and he didn't have all the allergies anymore. Anyways, I had never heard that before, but the guy came in yesterday, so anyways. Variance in flavor, and that's one of the things that, you know, you just, we talk about Beauvoir, and part of the thing about Beauvoir is if you go to France, and you get a certain wine from 1994, it's gonna taste different than 1995, right? Because the growing conditions in the soil and everything affects that type of grape. The same thing here, you know, we first started with our jalapeno pilsner when we first opened up in July, and there was lots of rain, and the jalapenos were somewhat hot, but more sweet. And then we don't taste every jalapeno, right? But near the end of the season, the jalapeno, it was a very dry season, the jalapenos were very hot, and the beer was a lot hotter. And we could have, I guess, equaled it out, but we didn't. And people loved it anyway. So I think it's one of those things where we found that our customers are willing to go with the variants, and they sort of enjoy that too. In terms of opportunities, well, you know, this is, I guess, a good thing for you, a bad thing for us potentially. But, you know, from a, if you're a farmer, right now there's about 1,900 breweries, but there's 855 in planning. I don't know what's going on. There's like this huge, massive, tons of people that are starting breweries. And so if you're a farmer, I guess it's a good thing if you want more people to consume what you're making. And Dorn talked about that, so I won't. So from a farmer's perspective, there's some good opportunities for crops rotation, especially with some of the grains. From brewers, I, you know, talked about it. There's a growing interest for people to know where their food comes from and where their drink comes from. So for us, that's one of the things that's very meaningful for us. And we founded the brewery because we truly believe in eating local. And it's a genuine interest, and for us, we want to support the local community. So it's really an opportunity to sort of live, you know, to sort of, we live one way, and we also own a business that's the same way. We don't have two different philosophies in life. And from both, it's a great cross-marketing perspective. You know, when we talk about our Meadows Mirth Fennel Flower Stout, or our Meadows Mirth, you know, Jalapeno Pilsner, it's good for them, they like it, because we can talk to each other's customer base. So there's a good cross-marketing opportunity there. And it's part of something that benefits the community. You know, the bigger we get, we use more product, then the more demand for them, that, you know, they can, so it's sort of one of those things where it's mutually beneficial, yes. This year for us, we're looking at, you know, how do we get a little bit bigger, because it's been a, it's hard to sort of keep up with the demand for beer. So that's one of the things we're looking at this year. We are, there's about five different farms we're working with. We're getting rhizomes. So this obviously will take a while. But we have some local farmers interested in planting hops, which is fantastic. So that's, this year is getting those going. We did a beer series, we're in the middle of a beer series this year, where we picked a farm and a local ingredient from that farm, and we called it Unafraid of the Dark, because we like stouts and porters a lot. So for example, from Burkford Farm, we got Hadatsa Squash, which is fantastic, and we're doing a Hadatsa Squash porter. We're playing around with a bacon, because we love this farm, New Roots, and so we wanted to do something from them, and so we're playing around with some bacon porter as well, and some of the other beers I just talked about. And always continuing to work with potential grain farmers. Now, one of the things that my cousin Andrea, if you're interested in talking to her, if you're a farmer, I have her, you can email me, I can put you in touch. She's been doing a lot of work with Heritage Grains to try and see what works well around here. And so that is a good focal point if you need an outlet to get your grains malted. But that being said, not every grain has to be malted, right? So we'll take raw oats, we'll take raw wheat, A bunch of the beers that we're going to try today actually have raw wheat in them because it gives it nice mouthfeel. It gives it head retention, which is nice. So not everything has to go through that malting process. And that's us smoking our grain for our campfire. Again, we use local applewood and just smoke some of the grain. 20 minutes.
Wow, that's
great. Any questions?
So your bacon beer, you get the grains from the farm, and you make beer with them, and the grains go back to the farm to feed the pigs,
yeah.
And then turn into bacon.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, yeah, so it's this whole big cycle thing, yeah. Yep. Drink a beer, eat a pig, I guess. I don't know.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
So you get your hops from New York, you said.
Yeah.
Do you know what varieties you
get? Yeah, we mostly get, I'll show you on a slide here. Oh, there's some bad slides here. We usually, it's mostly, Willamette is basically an all, yeah, here it is right here. Willamette hops, we get a whole bunch of different hops from them, but we get, let's see, I can't remember which are from Foothill Farms. Well, the Willamette are from Foothill, but we usually use Willamette in pretty much everything. Cascade, we use in our Hopstruck, which is our red IPA, and we use Summit. But the thing is, we're pretty much willing to use whatever is around. So if someone says to me, we have X hops, we're like, all right, you know, we'll brew something with it, right? It's not that we're tied to certain varieties. And the reason why we use Willamette and everything is because there was a lot of it available around here.
I know friends of ours have wild hops. Are you
yeah.
interested in wild hops at all? Or, you know, because they don't know what it is at this point. And when you're contacting farmers, what acreage are you asking them to plant?
This year is when we're going to start working more to talk about grain production.
Okay.
Last year, we sort of went to some of our farmers that we were friends with, like Brookford Farm. We'd known those guys for a while, so we said, and we knew they had, were making wheat, and so we worked out a plan to buy a bunch of wheat from those guys. The rest, my cousin has those relationships with the farmers. So, but we're, the whole vision one day would be to have a little farm with the, not to go and be all over the country, but it's to have maybe a farm with a brewery on it and to malt there. So when, to get to that point, we need to start working with local farms too, yeah. We are distributing, we self-distribute because we're tiny and we're in New Hampshire. 3 barrels doesn't go very far. Yeah. I thought I saw a hand over there. It's dry applewood, yeah. It's actually, because we're small enough, my dad went out, it was a present for me. He got a smoker from Home Depot, and we just put the applewood on one side, and we smoke it, and then the grains on the other side, so.
So do you do smaller batches for sort of pilot brews, or do you just go all in?
I don't know if you guys heard the question. It was, we brew with weird stuff. Do you pilots, or do you go all in? It varies. For the chai, for a couple of them, like the chai porter that we're working on, there's a White Heron's a really great tea place that's in New Hampshire on the seacoast area, and they make local chai. So we're doing a chai porter, and to do that, we actually had this recipe. Have a version never been kissed, we call it, so we don't put the maple syrup in it. So we use never been kissed and maple kiss wheat porter with varying levels of chai in it after we've brewed. So sometimes we'll do that. We'll have 1 gallon little jugs, like 10 of them, with different variations of different things in it. But to start a brewery, and you have to have at least one person who's somewhat crazy, I think, or to start any small business. So that's Annette. She's sort of a crazy sort of dreamer type, which is fantastic. Then you have me, the MBA type, who sort of, so if it was just me, I would do all these test batches, but since she's the brewer, a lot of times she just goes for it, and then it ends up working out, so I let her do that. So.
3 barrels.
Yeah. So.
Okay. Thank you very much.